This week, this will be the last, the message kind of in the family talk. Next week, obviously, I'll be beating up on the fathers. yeah, not a problem. So if you guys know of any, please invite them out. It doesn't have to be fathers, husbands, sons, it doesn't really matter, just men. We're going to be talking a lot just about a few different areas. But this week, we are ending up kind of the marriage talks. So if you're not married, this still can be used for you, because maybe one day you will. Or maybe you know people that are married that might come to you and ask for some advice at some point in time. So it'd be nice to give them some good ones. I've been told through this by quite a few people that they don't like what I'm hearing. And not that they were mad about it, just that they didn't want to hear what I was saying. And most of the time, I don't want to hear what I'm saying. Because it convicts me just as much as it convicts you guys. And I know that there's some hurting marriages and stuff like that in this church, and in the families of the people at this church. And so I pray that anything that has been talked about, that it would at least have some kind of effect. And today we're going to kind of talk about how awesome your spouse is. And for some of us, we might question that. But they is awesome. Did I lose me? Your spouse is awesome. They're a wonderful, wonderful blessing from God. And they actually are a fulfillment of something that's inside of you. Something that you were created with. Okay, so through this, I'm not telling everybody that they need to get married or that you should run out and get married. Because not everybody is meant to be married. And that's okay. You need to be married to God. But if you are, this definitely is for you. So if everybody would open up to Genesis chapter 2, we'll start there. Genesis chapter 2, obviously when I think about marriage, I go back to the first one. Why not start there, right? If that's the way and that was the one that God was physically instrumental in, was that marriage. So we might as well look at it and see what happened, things that went on, how Adam looked at Eve, how Eve looked at Adam, those kind of things. You see, when God created Adam, he didn't create him fully complete. Okay, and some people have questioned me about that. You know, well, what do you mean? You know, God didn't know what he was talking about when he created him? No, that's not the case. You see, God still had to work on things after he created him. He created the earth on the first day, but he kept working on it the next few days, right? It didn't have plants on it the first day it was created. No, it was completely covered in water. It didn't even have ground. So then he worked on that on the third day, and then the plants came along on the fourth day, okay? So once he creates something, he says that it's good. It is. It's wonderful. It's amazing. But he still works on it, okay? So Adam was created. But what he was lacking was this sense of community that was inside of him. Because God is communal. God is community. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Okay, that is community. That's how we all started. And so Adam, being created in the image of God, he had that inside of him. That he had a communal something, a communal need inside of him. But the only thing is, the kind of crazy thing about how God works is God just doesn't give it to him. First, he wants Adam to acknowledge his need. He needs to acknowledge his need for something else, for a helper, for a friend, for a helpmate. And so let's look here at what God does first off. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. The Lord God said, "It's not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals, all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. No suitable helper was found. So Adam is standing there. Who knows what kind of fruit he's eating, you know, at this point in time. Who knows what he's eating? You know, and all of a sudden God is having all of these creatures come before him. This is going to take a long time. Right? Everything that God created is coming before him, and Adam's got to name all of it. I'm sorry, for me, that would be kind of boring. That's just me. And so Adam, he's seeing all these, but the only thing is that Adam, when these two are coming up, he has to name male and female, okay? And so he's seeing that when he names the male, that right beside it is a female that he has to name. And so he's seeing that there's two of them. And I can see inside of Adam, he's going, there's one of me, but yet there's two of them. I don't understand this. And so he's going through, and what he's looking for somebody to be standing beside him. But Adam's not going to pick a horse or a a buffalo or something. You know, you look good. You come live with me. That'd be wonderful. No, that'd be weird, right? I mean, I don't have to go into that, but that would be a little different. But what God wanted to do is that He wanted to show Adam his need for something else. Because as Adam's naming these off, I can just see inside of him, he's going, but I need this. You see, not only for procreation, not only because they can make more of them, but I just need this. The two are together. They stand together. That's what I need. So let's read on a little bit. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. So right now, let me talk to the women just for a second. How beautiful your wedding day was, right? And if you're not married, you've dreamed about it. Some of the teenagers, you know, you dream about it since you're a little girl, all that kind of stuff. Think about this, how beautiful this was, okay? God just created Eden. Think about this sinless place. There is no ugliness in this. Your church might have been nice. You might have had good decorations and all that kind of stuff, but this is God-made decorations, okay? This is awesome. And then your father walking you down the aisle. You know, most of us are bawling. Most of the women are bawling because they finally realize, I'm marrying this guy. What am I doing? Can I run now? And I think it's the father's job to, no. You know, I think that's half of it. They have to drag them down the aisle up to him. You know, and some of us guys, we cried. I bawled like a little girl. You know, I did. It was just, it was an awesome time. Just that marriage time is awesome to know that father, and I'm sorry, but my father-in-law, he's a big guy. And I'm a big guy, but he's bigger than me, and he could really tear me up if he wanted to. At one point in time, I think he actually threatened to shoot me. But that's neither here nor there. But that he is bringing his daughter down to hand over to me. You know, and I remember how nervous I was when I went to ask Heather's dad if I could marry her. I mean, I was sick to my stomach because I thought, this guy can say no and beat me to a pulp all in the same time. And so I was nervous the whole time, you know, and I'm standing there, and then finally I was getting ready to leave. I almost didn't do it at that time because I was just so nervous. But then I asked if we could go into his office and ask him. And of course, obviously, he said yes. We didn't run away and just get married, but he said yes. But just, you know, the ladies, just that, oh, of the wedding time, you know. And why do you women, you cry at other people's wedding? You know, because you know it's just that's just such a lovely time, right? So that's what's going on right here. God just created Eve, and all of a sudden, He's walking her almost down the aisle to Adam. All right, now guys, I'm going to talk to you for a minute. You were just standing there naming off creature after creature after creature, and you didn't find anything that you needed. And then all of a sudden, God put you in a coma, a deep sleep. He put you in a coma, and you wake up, and your side's killing you. He just took a rib from your side. It hurts. It's got to. I don't care how good of a physician he is. You're waking up and you're going, you know, your vision's kind of blurry. Just woke up from a coma. And all of a sudden you're looking down and you see God walking with something. And I can just, you're kind of, whoa. You know, you're looking at Jesus going, man, whoo, whoa, man. And so that's actually how woman got her name, in case you didn't know that. Thank you. Some of you are keeping up with me. Whoa, man. But that had to be Adam's view, because he's looking at all these animals going, you know, me and you, we just don't go together. There's something that's just not right about that. And all of a sudden, he sees this. God created this woman specifically for Adam. Wow. Of course, he's going to be, oh. And so what's Adam do? Man, he is good. Okay, because you know, like the love notes that we write? Let's read what he said to his wife. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." I mean, that's a love. That's the first love note ever written in the Bible. That's the first. That's the first loving words that man has ever said. Created man has ever said. She is flesh of my flesh. She is bone of my bone. I think sometimes in our marriage ceremony, we need to say that. Because here in just a second, let's go ahead and read on. That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Adam and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. You see, they become one flesh. When you're married, you become one. I'm just not talking about the physical part of it, okay, because that is a part of it. The two become one. But what I'm talking about is that spiritually, I mean, you two become one. You see, there is a fulfillment that was created inside of us. We needed this. And so God gives that to us through that other person. You see, your wife or your husband was crafted specifically for you. That's how I view it. Heather was crafted specifically for me because God knew where I lacked, and so that's what He gave her. God knew what I didn't have, and so that's what He gave her. God knew what she lacked, and so that's what He gave me. And when you look at it, most marriages, opposites attract, right? I mean, I probably told this story before, but if you would have saw me and Heather when we were dating, you would have thought, what in the world has gotten into her? Because it wasn't a beautiful thing. All right? I mean, she was cheerleader, and she kind of grew up just straight-laced, and she was, you know, everything was in place. I met her, her towels were rolled up, and they were color-coordinated inside of her cabinet. She's fallen a lot since then. And it's my fault. It's my fault. It truly is. But then you have this that's walking, you know, and in the time, we lived in Central Ohio. So we're walking, you know, in Columbus, and then she's standing beside me. You know, at the time, I probably had black Converses on that had about 18 holes in them. I would have black pants with four different chains of different lengths hanging off the sides. I had two bracelets of spikes that, you know, came out to about like there on both wrists. I had black armbands that I wore. I had pitch black hair. Actually, I think it was three different colors when we got together. Mohawk, 8 inches up on top of my head. I had 19 piercings. Okay, so I glittered and I gleamed and I clanged and everything else when we're walking down. People are going to look, okay, when we're walking down there. But think about it, that's opposites, right? Somehow she looked through all of that and saw something that was deep inside. That's what makes me think she was crafted for me, because she saw past this. She didn't see that. She saw what was deep down inside. She saw what God had created for her. And then the same thing, that I got to see what God created for me. Somebody that wasn't going to judge me. Somebody was just taking me for who I was. And that's exactly what I was looking for. That's what I was screaming out there. So it's the same in your life. That your other half is your better half. Because they make you better. When I say that, you know, where's your better half? I mean it. Because they make you better. You're a better person with them. At least you should be. That's how it's supposed to be. You see, when I read through this last part and I see Adam and his wife were naked, were both naked, and they felt no shame. Some of us, we might get red faces and all that kind of stuff. That's all right. But what I see there is transparency. It's transparency. You see, they were just, this is all that I am. There wasn't any hiding. She could see everything that Adam was. And Adam could see everything that she was. This is it. They were naked. You couldn't hide wrinkles, bumps, pimples, or anything else. You couldn't hide that. This is it. This is what you get. And so that is our life. It should be with our spouse. Transparency. Not physical transparency, but emotionally. Your thoughts, your actions. There should be transparency there. You know, after so many years, people start, when they're married, they start finishing each other's sentences. They start knowing what each other is thinking. They start acting like each other. I really feel bad for my wife because she's starting that. Yes, thank you. But that's the way that it is, because there's transparency there. You see, I mean, this is what you get, and you said yes to it. I constantly say that. You said yes. I asked. You said yes. So guys, we kind of have a little bit up on them. You know, they agreed to us. We just asked. We needed them, and they said yes, that they would be one with us. It's an amazing thing. Marriage really is. It's supposed to be bound together by God Himself. And most of us got married in a church. And so we went through those vows. And we just didn't make those vows to the other person. We made those vows to God. And He was up there listening, going, okay, I hear every word that you say. That you say, yeah, for better or for worse. For richer, for poorer, all of these things. Do you really mean it? You know, and it's hard for us right then. Yeah, we mean it. Because guys, we're not thinking up here. Okay? We like that last verse. They were both naked. They felt no shame. We're not thinking up here. We're going, yes! All right! Woo! But then the women, I think sometimes they start crying during that because they're finally realizing, I'm really going to have to love this guy. for better or for worse, because it's getting worse right now.